recording.
Okay, so what all have we you know learned so far this semester, right? Let me just go back quickly and go over that. Right, so we started talking about what is the idea behind quantum mechanics, right? And some general concepts about interference, decoherence and all. So the principal idea behind quantum mechanics, right, is the concept of superposition, linear superposition. So the structure of quantum mechanics is based on the concept of a vector space. If you understand the concept, if you understand that, then many things about quantum mechanics, they become very, very clear. Okay, you might not understand why it is that way, right? I mean, because in physics, we are still trying to understand a lot of things about quantum mechanics, why they are the way they are. But you will understand at least what is going on and how to use those tools, right? And it will remove a lot of that mystery, right? So this is very, very important to realize that quantum states are vectors, right? Whether it is the state of a free particle on a line or in a box or in any other potential, right? Or the state of an electron around a hydrogen atom, or the state of a spin one half particle in some quantum computer, say, right? Or the quantum state of this bottle of water, right? So anything has a quantum state, right? Any object, any system is described by such quantum state, right? The quantum state might be very complex, but it's always, you can always describe it as a vector, right? And this leads us, this concept of superposition, right, it leads us to interference between different possibilities, right? And interference is what leads to quantum phenomenon, right? So one of the best illustrations of this is the wave particle duality of nature, right? Of matter. So you can use electrons, for instance, in a interference experiment, right? Now, when you have these quantum states, right? So a quantum state can represent a particle which is localized at a point, or it can represent a particle which is spread out. So we use different ways to identify what we mean by localized and spread out. The common tool is that of standard deviation or variance, right? So to calculate this, what we need is we need to understand how to calculate the mean value of some observable, right? So our observables, what are observables? Our states are vectors. What are observables? Observables are operators which act on those vectors, right? So they are matrices basically. And what is the expectation value of an observable? It is given by an expression of this form, right? This is called the expectation value, right? And now, if you want to calculate, for instance, the uncertainty in some observable, you need the expectation value of x of that observable and also the square of that observable, right? So how do you calculate the square of the expectation value? The expectation value of the square of that observable? Well, you just put in x square, right? For instance, in this thing, you just square the operator and then you calculate this. Now, again, all of these exercises, I expect that you have all done them. right? If you do them, then you know, you will be able to follow what's going on. So then, you know, what is the correspondence between classical and quantum systems, right? This is what I talked about. And well, in this case, we had, I was talking about the electric field of, you know, say some particle and the quantum state of some system. Okay. So this was right. And then, right. And then we come to the classical quantum correspondence. Okay. So the state of a classical system is given by what? It's given by something like a position, momentum, energy, or angular momentum, right? And the state of a quantum system is given by a vector, right? Now, what are all of these points? What are all of these quantities? These quantities are points in what is called phase space, right? So phase space is a, what we call in geometry, it's a manifold, right? These are elements of a vector space. Right? On this vector space, you have the concept of, because it's a complex vector space, in addition to the transpose operation, you also have a complex conjugation. So you can combine those two things to form a dagger operation, which is called the Hermitian adjoint. Right? Now, in classical mechanics, the dynamics of a system is given by something like Newton's equation, right? In quantum mechanics, the dynamics is given by Schrodinger's equation. So I didn't go into this in great detail, but this Hamiltonian that we see in quantum mechanics, it is also present in classical mechanics, right? But then I don't know to what extent you have studied Hamiltonian mechanics, so I haven't talked a lot about it. Right, and then I went into a discussion of all these vector spaces. What are the properties of vector spaces? Right, so what is the key property of a vector space? Is that if you take the linear sum of any two vectors, it is also a vector. Right, so what is a linear sum? It's a vector multiplied by a scalar. Right, so and then you take sums of such quantity, and that sum is also a member of your vector space. So you say, we say that the vector space is closed under linear combinations. And if these scalar or multiples, right, if these are real numbers, we say it's a real vector space. But they can also be complex numbers, in which case it's a complex vector space. But the everything remains the same in real or complex vector, right? You have the concept of a basis vector, right? And then you can write any vector in your vector space as a linear superposition of these basis vectors. You have the concept of orthogonality and orthonormality of a basis, right? And okay, so then right, and then once you have all of this, once you understand that okay, states are vectors, how do you understand, for instance, the Schrodinger equation, right? So this is the Schrodinger equation. Now, many of you have seen the Schrodinger equation. I suppose all of you must have seen it in your BSc, right, at some point. But when you first studied the Schrodinger equation, nobody really told you anything about the fact that this object, this wave function that you are studying, is actually a vector, right? So it must have come as a bit of a surprise to you. So the fact that it's a vector is what is leads to the idea that you can take linear combinations of these objects, right? So just like we take linear combination of any two vectors, we can take a linear combination of any two of these wave functions, right? But in what is the precise way, precise sense in which this object is a vector, right? Psi of x. Psi of x itself is not a vector. Psi of x is the component of the state psi. It is the component of the state psi at the point x, right? So x is like the index of a vector, which indexes the components of that vector. Okay? So when you want to define, for instance, the length of a vector, right? If you have some vector, let's say like this, ui, ei, right? And you want to talk about the length of the vector. What do? You take the dot product. And the dot product gives you something like this, summation over I ui squared, right? So you are summing over this index I. So same way, if you want to ask what is the length of this vector, what do? You multiply the components, that gives you psi of x squared, and then you sum over all the components, which gives you an integral over x, right? And in quantum mechanics, the interpretation of the length of a vector is that of probability, right? Okay, so now in the Schrodinger equation, we have, right, so this point is very, very important. Okay, it is an abstract notion, and it takes a little bit of time to understand, but it is very important to understand this idea, right? So the idea that these objects are vectors, but vectors in which vector space? Right. So vector space, what is this vector space? So it is a space of all functions, basically, right? All functions which satisfy this requirement that you can take the length of that vector, and that length is a finite quantity. Okay? And this vector space is infinite dimensional. Why do we say it is infinite dimensional? Because you have an infinite number of points on the real line, right? So each point corresponds to a component of the vector. So how many components are there? There are an infinite number of components, right? But there is nothing to be scared of when talking about infinite dimensional vector spaces. There's nothing scary about them. They work just the way as finite dimensional vector spaces. Okay, so then I explain to you what is this concept of a Hamiltonian, right? So we have this Hamiltonian which we are using in the Schrodinger equation. Where does it come from, right? So then I talked about classical mechanics and explain the concept of phase space to you, right? Now again, presumably you have some background, some exposure to these ideas, right? Otherwise it would be very difficult to follow what's going on, okay? And, right, so then this was all just a review, a very quick review of Hamilton's equations. And of course, this being a class in quantum mechanics, I cannot go into great detail about what are Hamilton's equations, where they come from. my hope is all of this is being covered in your classical mechanics course, right? If it's not, well, please make sure that you tell your instructor to cover it quickly, okay? Because otherwise you'd have to tell them that you're getting confused in your quantum course. Now, right, so then we go from this concept of a classical Hamiltonian, which is the sum of the potential, the kinetic energy and the potential energy, right? We go from the classical one to the quantum one, right? And then how do you get this quantum Hamiltonian? What is this quantum Hamiltonian? So this, you replace these quantities, the position, the momentum, you replace them with operators, right? And how do these operators operate, right? So the x of x is simply acts as a multiplicative operator. P acts as a derivation. P is given by a derivation with respect to x, right? And then later on, I went on to give you a motivate why P behaves in this way. Why is it a derivation, right? Because this is also one of the mysterious aspects which is not explained very well when you first learn about quantum mechanics. You are told that the momentum is this thing, derivative with respect to x, but then you're left scratching your head as to why it should be that, right? And so the reason it is given by this is because it can be traced back to the wave nature of matter, right? So in the wave nature of matter, we have de Broglie's hypothesis, right? So according to de Broglie's hypothesis, a wave with a certain wavelength corresponds to a particle with a momentum, right? And so if you look at the simplest possible wave, what is this? This is the simplest possible wave, right? It's a sinusoidal function of position and of time. And then we ask, what is the momentum of this wave, right? So the momentum is encoded within this parameter k. K is related to the wavelength by this expression, 2 pi by lambda. And that tells you that the momentum of the particle can be written as h bar times k, right? So this object represents a particle which has a momentum h bar k. But that momentum is hidden inside this function. So the question is, how do you get this outside the function? How do you pull it out? One way to do that is to take the derivative. When you take the derivative, this k will come out of the function, right? As a consequence of the chain rule, right? So, and then you identify this as the operator, right? And this as the eigenvalue of that operator, right? So once you understand a little bit more about eigenvalues and eigenvectors, then I hope that, you know, and you go back again and you look at this, then I hope it becomes a little bit more clear why momentum is related to the derivation, okay? But it's not quite an eigenvalue in this form yet, because here f is a cosine and this is a sine, right? So in an eigenvalue equation, you need to have the same vector on both sides of your equal sign. So in this case, we take a second derivative so that we get a cosine on the right hand side also. And then we identify the eigenvalue as a momentum squared, right? And the operator as this minus I h bar d by dx. Now it is possible to write down the eigenstates of the momenta, right? So if this is the momentum operator, it is possible to write down the eigenstates. What are the eigenstates? well, you just solve this differential equation. The eigenstates are exponentials, e to the ik plus minus ik. Okay? So, okay, now let's see. Then we started talking about an actual system, right? So we have the concept of states, we have the concept of operators and a Hamiltonian. So now let's talk about system. So the system is that of a infinite potential well. Okay. Are you all there? Are you listening? Is it, am I? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
If anybody has any questions, you please stop and ask me. Okay. Right. And so we look at this infinite potential well problem. And in this case, our potential is this step function, right? It is like, a ladder, well, or, a step, it's piecewise continuous, right? So it's like constant here, then constant here, then constant here. So it's like constant, different constant values on different parts of the line, right? And so we can solve the Hamilton, this, we have the Hamiltonian, which is here, the kinetic plus potential, right? We know how to write down our operator, our kinetic energy operator, right? And what is our potential? Well, our potential in the inside of the well is just zero. So we can solve for our states, right? And we find that our solutions are given by this kind of an expression. Right. So then I went on to, talking about how to find the solution by looking at the state in the three different regions. And then what happens in the region outside the well and inside the well? Outside the well, you get two different solutions, but one solution you have to throw away because that has an infinite probability. So when you do this integration, the area under that curve goes to infinity, right? So you have to throw that away because you cannot have infinite probability, right? That means probability can never be more than one, right? And so when you throw away this one solution, so in this case, you throw away the red curve and you keep the green curve on this side, what is this curve now? This looks like this, e to the minus k, kx, right? And k prime x. And what is k prime? K prime is this quantity. Right? So k prime is this quantity. And right now in this quantity, I've taken u to be a finite number, but we can take u to be infinite. So we take u to be infinite. When we do that, what happens to k prime? K prime also goes to infinity. So when the exponent goes to infinity, what happens to the full thing? It goes to zero, right? Because exponent of minus infinity is zero. So for the infinite potential well, the solution outside the potential well is very simple. It's just zero. Inside the potential well, the solution is inside the potential well, the solution is just a superposition of plane waves, right? But we have not yet found we still need some way to determine what these coefficients C and D are, and what is there any restriction on K? right? So how do we do that? Well, we have to use some properties of the state of this psi. What are those properties? This is the fact that it has to be continuous and that differentiable, right? So that means its first derivative should exist and it should be continuous everywhere. If it's not continuous, then what happens is that you cannot have a well-defined solution of this differential equation. This is a differential equation, and it's a differential equation which involves the second derivative of your state, right? So if your wave function is not differentiable, then if the first derivative doesn't exist, right, then you can't define the second derivative at all, right? Okay, so we use this continuity of the wave function, right? And what this continuity tells us is that the value of the state at the boundary of this potential should be the same whether you come from the left or you come from the right. That gives us a restriction on these coefficients C and D, right? And we find that it gives us a restriction on the momentum also. And we find that the momentum can only be an integer multiple of pi by L. What does this correspond to? This corresponds to standing waves, right? So you think of your potential as a box with closed boundary, which is closed on both sides, right? So closed boundary conditions. And then you ask, what are the standing waves that can fit inside the box, right? And the standing waves will have precisely the momenta, which is given by K by L, this pi by L. So once we get this solution, we have the momentum, we can calculate what the energy is, right? Because the energy is just P squared by 2m. And what is P? P is h bar square times k square, right? P square, right, is h bar square times k square. So we find that the energy of our state goes as n square, right? And then we still have to determine this normalization. To determine the normalization, you have to integrate the wave function, make sure its length is equal to 1. And then you find from that exercise that your state has a normalization constant, which is given by this root 2 by L. And again, this is something that I expect all of you have worked out, okay? All right, so then we come to what the consequences of this. What are the consequences? Well, we have a free particle. Sorry, we have a particle in this potential. What happens as a consequence of the fact that the energy levels are quantized? So the consequence is that the system can absorb or emit energy only in finite packets, right? Which are given by the difference between any two successive energy levels, right? So this is the origin of the notion of quantization of energy. And the same concept goes over for when you talk about atoms or photons or anything else, right? So, and then we have the concept of what is called a ground state and excited state. Ground state is the lowest energy state. And what we see is that even the lowest energy state, which corresponds to n is equal to 1, has a non-zero energy, right? So the example that I gave is that of putting a marble, right? Marble meaning, in Hindi, we call it a kancha, right? Goti, goli, anything, a little small particle in a ball, in a bowl, and we let it settle down. What will happen? It will reach the bottom of the bowl, and it will sit there. It will have zero energy and zero momentum if it's a classical particle. But if it's a quantum particle, it will have some energy, even at the small, the lowest energy it can have will not be zero. And that is a consequence of the something called the uncertainty principle. Okay. And the uncertainty principle, we studied that later in detail, where it comes from. It comes from the fact that operators don't commute. Right? So this was just an introduction to the uncertainty principle. Right? And then I talked about in greater detail about the concept of uncertainty, the concept of random variables and histograms. Okay. But these are all of this statistical background, again, you should have exposure to, right? So I have discussed it, but maybe not in as much detail as some of you might like. And then once we have these states, once we have these solutions, what can we do with these solutions, right? What do they tell us about the system, right? So what they tell us, what this state tells us is it gives us probability. What probabilities for what? For the location of the particle, right? So I gave you some simple examples of how you can ask, what is the probability of finding the particle between point A and point B, right? And then this brings us back again. So now we are looking at the calculation of all these expectation values and things which we mentioned earlier, but very briefly, right? So now we're looking at it in greater detail. And then you have these exercises, which I give you from time to time. And it's very important to do those. And so we get the momentum, the uncertainty in the momentum, the uncertainty in position, so on. Okay, so this is the infinite potential well. We've talked about the solutions, the energy levels. We've talked about the uncertainty principle applied to this problem, right? But one of the things that we haven't really talked about is the vector aspect of these states, right? So because I have been saying from the very beginning that these states are actually vectors, right? So what does that mean? Right? It means, so then I went into this in great detail. And again, I hope that if any of you have any doubts, you will contact me, okay, about what all of this means if you are not able to understand it, okay? About what this kind of an expression means. All right. So the point is that these vectors, that these solutions that we have, right? What are they? They are vectors, but more importantly, they are basis vectors. Right? So it means that we can write down any state of the system as a superposition of the basis vectors. So you might think that once you have solved, once you have these states, you might think, okay, I have solved the problem. But you should keep in mind that the system can have any state, okay? What is the most general state of the system of this particle in a potential well? The most general state looks like this. It is some superposition of all of these states. Okay, so your n goes from 1 to infinity. C of n is your weight of that basis vector. And what is psi of n? Psi of n is one of these options. right? So this is the most general state. And then if these are basis vectors, well, then they should have some properties. One of those properties is orthogonality, right? And then I showed you that they are indeed orthogonal. Just give me 1 second. Okay, sorry about that. That was an important phone call from my dentist. Okay, so then I went to talked about how these states are actually orthogonal, and this involves a little bit of integration and so on and so forth. So again, right, and so then we have this, the state of a system is any, okay, now all of the rest of this, what is it? It is all just again talking more and more about the vector space concept. All right, so once we have talked about all of this quantums, this solutions, and we've talked about an example of, we looked at a real system. Now we come to the concept of how we perform transformations on these states, right? So we have to understand, for instance, one thing is that any vector space has a set of basis vectors, but that set of basis vectors is not unique. You can always perform a rotation in a vector space which changes your basis, right? So such a rotation is given by an operator or a matrix, which has a property that it's a unitary matrix, right? Now, as an example, we considered such kind of a system. Now, this is a system which is a very simple system. This is the simplest possible quantum system. This has only two states, up state and down state. If you want to think in terms of a particle on a line, it's like saying the particle can be only at two positions. Let's say x1 and x2, right? And then again, all of this is just algebra, right? And then after the discussion of unitary matrices, we come to the discussion of Hermitian matrices, Hermitian operators. And the fact that Hermitian operators, why are Hermitian operators important? Because Hermitian operators are what give us information about our system, right? So if you actually want to get some information from that state, like the momentum of the state or the energy of the state, how do you get that information, right? You have to get it by applying a Hermitian operator to your state. Why Hermitian? Because Hermitian operators have real eigenvalues, and it is that eigenvalue which is the result of a measurement. Okay, and so then again, continuing with this example of a spin 1/2 system, I talked about different Hermitian operators, which are these Pauli matrices, and what their eigenvalues are, right? And then I discussed how this is actually implemented in the real world in the form of this Stern-Gerlach experiment, right? Okay, and then we come to the concept of measurement. Measurement is the idea that I have these states, right? That's fine, that's wonderful. But now what? At the end of the day, I need to get some information from that system. And that information is obtained by this process, which is called measurement, right? And this measurement is a mysterious process. We have still not understood it fully, right? So we have a certain sort of algorithm for what measurement is, okay? A recipe, right? We don't yet have a full explanation of why that recipe takes this form, but We know that it works. So the recipe is the following, that when you perform a measurement of a system, you use a Hermitian operator. The system collapses into an eigenstate of that Hermitian operator. And the result of that measurement is given by the corresponding eigenvalue, right? So all of this can be illustrated with this example of a spin 1/2. Okay, are you all there? Do I still have you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and do you have a class at 9?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'll wrap up. Then there are a lot of things. We talked about, again, this relationship between discrete and continuous. This is one of the most confusing aspects when you first look at quantum mechanics. So I have again talked about how to understand this state, this object as a state vector, as a something which corresponds to, you know, how do you think of it as a vector? So I talked about a discrete system as an example, okay? And then this also leads us now to, when we're talking about measurement, we have to talk about our position eigenstates, and our position eigenstates are orthogonal. But their orthogonality is given by something called the Dirac delta function, which is different from the Kronecker delta. Okay. So this is the measurement procedure. All right. And all of this measurement, all of this talk about measurement, it brings us to the notion of the fact that there are observables which are incompatible. Okay. What are incompatible observables? Incompatible observables are those which don't commute with each other. Okay. So all of this, the rest is all some more details about the delta function and how to do computations with it, okay? So then we come to this notion of incompatible observables. And this incompatibility of observables is given by the fact that whenever two operators don't commute, they are incompatible. Incompatible means that you cannot perform a simultaneous measurement of both of those operators and get a certain answer for both of them. I explained this, and again, this is a bunch of mathematics, right? That if two operators commute, then they have the same eigenstates. If they have the same eigenstates, then the process of measurement will lead to a collapse into that same set of eigenstates. And you can get a definite answer for the eigenvalues of both of those operators. But if they don't commute, they don't have the same set of eigenstates, and there is uncertainty when you measure those operators together simultaneously, in the sense that one after the other in either order. Okay, and then this uncertainty is expressed in terms of this equation, which we haven't derived. We will derive it at some point, but we haven't derived it yet. Okay. And then, well, I filled in a little bit of a gap, which I had left, which was the derivation of the reality of Hermitian of eigenvalues and the orthonormality. Right. And then I talked about the representation, this kind of a representation, the completeness of states. What is a projection operator? And then in the last lecture, of course, we just went through some exercises. Okay, so this is what we have done so far, and this is what will be on your midsem. So your midsem will be about all of these ideas: orthonormality, measurement, collapse, operators, infinite potential well, spin 1/2 system. Again, I will ask very simple questions, but very foundational questions. Okay. So that's it for now, and I will see you all tomorrow when we will continue to talk about the time evolution of quantum systems. All right. Thank you. If you have any questions,
are welcome to ask.
But since it's already time for the next class and you don't want to wait, then I'll...
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Kusum.
So can you share the course plan?
Yes, Kusum. I will send that to you today. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Anything else? Okay, then I will see you all tomorrow. Bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.